I'm training. We have come full circle. We drove all the way to here. We rest. Then we came out to go vacation. Now we're here. It truly became a full circle. Are you ready to go home? Basically, I'm going to get into subtle to get into the car. Hi. Thank you.
dinner, and honestly, it's by the grace of God my marriage is still together, because I would throw it up to my husband probably for 5 years, and it was probably another 9 years from the affair, 9 years after, that I did a Bible study and I started to realize I didn't know what forgiveness was. And I would throw it up to my husband, and I would say all the time, like if we had a little argument, you owe me. I was not a nice wife. Yeah, and I felt like Dr. Jekyll and Mrs. Hyde, I guess, because I felt like I'd go to church and I would say, I was in charge of women's ministry and the children's ministry, but I would resent. And, oh, I will tell you this. When my husband would be up in front of everyone speaking and everyone thought he was just the greatest thing, I resented it. And I think every Sunday, it just gave me another little notch in my anger or my bitterness. I was like, it bothered me that I was in so much pain and people loved him.
What was your relationship with God like as you walked through that? Did any of that resentment you felt towards your husband, was any of that directed toward God?
Absolutely. And I was very angry with God. You know, God, I prayed for a godly man, a godly marriage. I wanted nothing else but to have an amazing ministry to bring glory to God. And I just was like, God, why? Why? And I always said, God, what did I do to deserve this? You know, what did I do to cause this? So, yes, I was very angry with God for a long time. And, you know, Christian music started really changing in the 90s. The more I listened to worship music, honestly, that was my life.
There's the football stadiums. There's two of them near each other. Near the another football field. And that's a, is it a baseball field? And then there. The football field.
It's over there with that oval. It's like a football stadium.
There's so many stuff that is near each other.
Right.
Is that a tennis stadium over there? Why do they need so many football fields in one area? I guess a lot of football fans. Why is St. Louis so obsessed with football?
most times, like, make sure your seatbelts are fast and your seat back and tray table pull up right lock position. All you carry items underneath the seat in front of you, leaving it around your feet clear. We're going to pass through the cabin one final time, pick up our remaining cups, your glasses, newspaper, wrappers, and the truck.
Now is to go home.
Thank you.
Southwest Airlines on this flight. You're welcome to St. Louis. Please stay seated with your seatbelts fastened. Don't get the gate in the fan fast. The seatbelt sign is turned off. You take care of opening overhead bins as items placed or could have shifted during flight and could fall out. If you're connecting to another Southwest Airlines city plane, check on the gate area of the TV monitor for your proper flight and gate number. This flight does continue on to Orlando. If you're going on to Orlando, please stay in that scene you're in right now. We need to count you. We'll let you know once you've been counted. Again, if you're going to Orlando, do not change seats. Do not exit the aircraft. Let us just get you counted real quick.
We're not going to Orlando.
We'll let you know after we get your count and it's confirmed that it's correct.
That red light? I mean that red light over there?
No, right here. Look, out this window.
I can't. It's hard to see it when it's dark. Oh, there it is.
Bright
light in the sky right over there. Yeah?
Bright
light, it's another plane coming in. The stars. Guys. Thank you.
5 miles, take exit 10B to merge onto I-270 east toward Chicago.
Sovereign nation, and you know, you can't let human beings go that. And that's why emergency rooms will continue to take anybody that walks through the door. You must. You really got it. I mean, it is the humane thing to do. The inhumane thing to do, the inhumane, the real thing that could be prevented, is what is bringing them here.
Yes.
Exit 159 onto Fayette Avenue.
And another wave of J6 subjects are about to be referred to the FBI's Daytona Beach Resident Agency for investigation and arrest.
Wow.
He says, the Washington, D.C. field office is manipulating FBI case management protocol and farming out to you.
Take the exit, then turn right onto East Fayette Road toward Effingham.
Cases to field offices across the country to create the false impression that right-wing domestic violence is a widespread national problem that goes far beyond.
At the light, use the right lane to turn onto East Fayette Road toward Effingham.
It's January 6th. As a result, he was listed as lead agent in cases he had not investigated.
Turn right.
Shut up. The supervisor had not signed off on it in violation of FBI policy. FBI domestic terrorism cases are being opened on innocent American citizens who were nowhere near the Capitol, based on anonymous tips.
In 1.6 miles, turn right onto South Willow Street.
FBI hotline or from Facebook spying on their messages. These tips are turned into investigative tools called Guardians after the FBI software that collates them. The FBI has post facto designated a grassy area outside the Capitol as a restricted zone when it was not restricted on January 6th in order to widen the net of prosecutions. And the last point, the Jacksonville area was inundated with Guardian notifications and FBI agents were dispatched to conduct surveillance and knock on people's doors, including people who had not been in Washington, D.C. on that day or who had been to the Trump rally but didn't go inside the Capitol.
I remember thinking, it's gotten so much worse because I guess they've established brand new public norms. They've always been doing what they want to do behind the scenes.
In 1 mile, turn right onto South Willow Street.
But especially with Russiagate, it was incredible to see people, especially those who wanted to see Donald Trump destroyed by this, be like, oh, well, this, oh yeah, if you support Trump, you support all these crimes we found.
Yeah.
That supposed outrage is seventh grade Christmas play, 1997, acting horrible. So, I mean, it's funny. That's funny. Then there's a business opportunity in this, and then there's also the fear of, wow, they're really trying to destroy me right here, right now.
I haven't gotten to listen to it yet, but Del Bigtree had Alex Jones on, and everybody's talking about that interview and how like absolutely broken he is.
What?
Well, I mean, I don't know. Sure. I guess he's becoming a little bit more weighted down by everything. Peach. Yeah. But
he had Alex Stein 99 on hosting yesterday.
InfoWars?
Yeah.
Yep.
And you should have seen Alex Stein 99 doing his Alex Jones impression, ripping his shirt off and talking about the satanic group, like eating babies off. Anyway, that's it for today. We'll go into the weekend on that note. You have been listening to the Dark to Light podcast with...
Thank God it's Friday, Val. And...
Beans! You can hear us every Monday, Wednesday, Friday at 2:30 Eastern Time on TuneIn, Stitcher, Apple iTunes, Google Podcasts, iHeartRadio, Spotify, and RadioInfluence.com. We'll see you back here on Monday.
Later.
This week's Agree or Disagree, we are going to go to two different Reddit posts I saw, which were, one was from the Reddit user 4soup3809, and the other one is
God's story has been unfolding since the beginning of time.
us to really be a family. I come back home. This is in March of 1996. A few months later, he goes to a Promise Keepers men's conference. He comes home from the Promise Keepers and he confesses everything to me. So it was gut-wrenching. Now, the other thing about my personality, and when you go through counseling and the older we get, the more you learn about yourself, I know now I am an extremely forgiving person. So maybe that's merciful. Maybe it's a gift of mercy. But immediately he's sobbing and crying. And I'm comforting him, saying, it's okay, I forgive you. So I immediately, without even thinking about the consequences and what this is doing to my heart, begin to forgive him. It's not until a few weeks, later that I begin to have this anger and rage. And honestly, I'm not an easily angry person. I didn't know what to do with it. I've never felt this way. And the anger and the rage was so destructive and so uncontrolled. I began to see another counselor. We went to a counselor together, and this counselor said, okay, you've confessed it, you've dealt with it, wash your hands, you're all done, everything's good. And I was like, no, I'm not good. I'm not good. So I had my own counselor, and again, I just didn't know how to handle it, and a counselor just wasn't helping me. I think now there are so many counselors that know how to handle betrayal. Again, I felt like I was alone on my own dealing with this.
Were you sharing that with anybody else? Did anybody outside of your counselors know what was going on?
No.
Oh, wow. So all this time he's pastoring, so there's this pressure to continue to appear to be in this amazing marriage when in reality you're devastated.
Yes, yes.
What did that feel like to walk through that?
I felt fake. I felt like I had to perform. And again, I got very good at pretending normal, but it was the hardest thing to do. I was a mess. And I sought my physical doctor, my doctor, to maybe try to get on some antidepressants, and they were like, no, you don't need them. I didn't know what to do. I really didn't. There just wasn't a lot of resources at that time, books. People just didn't talk about it. I was so angry and bitter. And